What's up, guys? Welcome back to a new video. Today we're going to be looking at how to deal with Nidus Swarmos. This has been one of the most requested things to deal with, because no one really knows how to beat it. I am not entirely sure how to beat it either, but I think I have a pretty good way of dealing with it. Like, it's not perfect, but I think it's a start, and I think if you follow this properly, you shouldn't have too much trouble with Swarmhouse Nidus. So we're assuming our opponent plays 3-base Swarmhouse Nidus, and we're opening with the double Oracle opener, which I made a guide on last week. So if you haven't seen that, be sure to check that out, because I'll assume that this is the opener that you picked, and from there on out, we'll look at some reactions against the Swarmhouse Nidus. Of course, there's some general ideas at play as well, so even if you play different openers, this will still should be useful. So let's get into it. I won't be looking too much at the build. I'll be looking at, from about the 5 or 6 minute mark on, we'll be looking at how to scout, how to check your opponent's army movement, and what your own army movement should look like. So we have the standard setup. This is a ladder game that I played a couple of days ago. We have the standard setup. We have our two oracles flying around. One of the main things we want to check when we with our oracles flying around is we want to see the gas count that our opponent has. Now, usually the way it works is that 4 gases mean that Zerg is most likely all-inning you. 5 gases means that it's still possible that they're all-inning you, but it's also possible that if they take a fort base and build a bunch of drones, that they can play a very Ling-heavy style, usually not with heavy tech units. So most of the time, Hydra Bane or Hydra Lurker won't be played with 5 gases. That will be at least 6 gases. And 6 gases just means they'll get a bunch of drones most of the time. They'll get a heavier tech style. This can be Ravager Ling Bane. This can be Muta. This can be Infestor Roach Swarm Host. I mean, just a Roach Swarmhouse Nidus, Roach Hydra Lurker. It can be a lot of things, basically. Basically, anything that is macro related. But anything less than 6 gas, what I like to do is I just match their gas count. And if I don't see 6 gas, I'll just keep adding more static defense in my bases, make sure that no Niduses can get up. You see, I have good vision with these two pylons in my main base as well. Make sure no Niduses can go up in the main base. All right, we've arrived at the 5 minute mark. So at this point, we should have full vision of our main base. This is probably the most important thing if you're playing against any kind of Nidus, is that it can go up in your main base. Usually if a Nidus gets up in your main base, you kind of lose the game. Sounds annoying, but it's the way of the world. So better learn how to deal with it instead of complaining. Two oracles, while trying to do some damage, should be scouting at least the two outside bases. So these two bases should be scouted by the oracles, and then especially which gases are taken. So I see right now that this gas is taken, and I know that these gases aren't taken. So I have 3 gases that I know aren't taken. These are the 3 gases I want to focus myself on. I want to know if these get taken or not. So when my secondary scout comes, in this case my hallucination, together with my observer, I like to send my observer to the natural to check these 2 gases, but the hallucinations will be going around these gases, making sure he takes them. So here I see, oh, he takes these 2 gases, and then I need to confirm only if this gas is taken. And at that point, in theory, I'm allowed to macro up. I can, you know, I take my own 6 gas and stuff like that. Try to split up the hallucinations as well to try and find the tech. Observer is in front to try and find the tech. That's the first step, of course, trying to find what tech your opponent is getting. Now, I get lucky this game. He builds his Nidus network straight beneath my observer. Now, whenever you see a Nidus network, a good reaction is to immediately start a Void Ray. This is to both deny Overlords from getting vision in your main base, but also from being able to patrol an area, which otherwise you might not be able to go with your main army, to deny a Nidus there. Especially against Swarmos, that's important. But if it's like a Roach all-in Nidus, then it's also important to get this Void Ray, because you want to deny their vision. And a Void Ray can deal perfectly fine with a Nidus by itself. So It's a good unit to immediately build. Another thing you want to do is you want to get some static defense at your third base. Don't forget to add extra gateways as well, though. It's very important to do that. And something that you might want to consider is sending some of your so-called useless units. Just send them out as pullers. So in this case, my Adept and my Zealot are relatively useless. Like they don't cost a lot. Don't have a lot of DPS. They're not essential to my army. Just send them out to spot for any potential Nidus. There could be one here. Could be one here. This is possible. A little more unlikely. This is the main area. On almost every map, if you play against Nidus Swarm Host, which I've seen this infestation pit, so I know it's Nidus Swarm Host. The area which is closest to your main, and you can't walk there easily, so in this case I need to walk all the way over here to get to the Nidus. It's the best one for the Zerg to get up, because they basically get a free wave that will do guaranteed damage once this Nidus gets up. The wave can't really be cancelled, army most likely is out of position, won't be able to defend the third at the same time, so if there's one area that you want to deny the Nidus from, it's this area. That's why I sent my two Oracles here, because my Void Ray isn't quite out yet. Perhaps I could have Chrono Boosted it. On three bases, we want to go up to 10 gates and one robotics facility, at least. Continue our upgrades and get static. Especially batteries are very nice. On top of that, the way that we build from a robotics facility is we get an Observer, an Immortal, and then a Prism. And the Prism we keep with our army in case a Swarmost wave comes, and you pick up the units that get attacked by the Locust wave. So here my Void Ray spots the Nidus, and the goal is to be sure to deny this Nidus. You see, I have some Oracles flying around here. This is also an important area. But these areas, imagine if he gets a Nidus here, or a Nidus here. It's annoying, but it's not the end of the world, because my main army usually is positioned around my third base anyway. That means that if he gets a Locust wave out there, that I'm already in position, I can just defend my third base. Especially if I have sufficient static defense, it should be absolutely no issue. So just keep your army around your third and use air units and individual useless units like the Adept. And here's a Stalker, which I won't need anymore, to just patrol areas. And they're kind of defended by the air units. You know, I just fly around with my Oracles. That's all you're doing. You shouldn't be thinking too much about counter-attacking at this point. What you want to do is you want to survive. As you see, I'm not even getting Storm. I'm not getting +2. That's a mistake. You should be getting +2 as soon as possible. That's actually kind of important. But I'm not getting Storm. It's because once you get Storm, it's very difficult to chase an army most of the time. It's way easier with a lot of Archons. Also, the first few waves get a lot easier if you get Archons. I usually only start getting Storm once I start thinking about moving out. If I'm not planning on moving out, most of the time I'm not really getting Storm that fast. Because in a defensive ability, Archons with batteries are completely fine against Locust, no matter how many Swarmhost he gets. So, just continue denying Nidus is very important. Once you feel a little more confident with your army movement, perhaps you can move a little up here, grab this tower with a Zealot. My Stalker here did some work, found the Locust wave, and here's my main army to deal with it. I see that a lot of the Locusts are basically timing out, so I'm like, you know what, I don't need to immediately fight it. And there we go. The moment he goes back into a Nidus, it's also very important to send units there to clear up the Nidus, because you don't want there to be three different Nidus worms from which he can pick. You want there only to be the new one which you need to find. It makes things a lot easier. Now, if you're not sure where his main roach army is, in this case he kept it at home and didn't actually have many roaches, mainly swarm host. But if you don't know, for safety, you can get a prism with two immortals, send it to where you suspect the Nidus is, kill the Nidus, and then go back home flying. Because they don't really get air units with this. They can't afford it. They don't have a lot of money. So I start my +2. I add some extra batteries for safety. And I'm starting to feel pretty good in this game. I'm not completely stabilized, but I'm pretty close to stabilizing. Usually around 160, 170 supply. From that point on, you can start moving on the map. And once you start moving on the map and there's no Nidus worms up, it means that he will need to start using the Swarmhost defensively. And if you can force Swarmhost use defensively, most of the time you win. because you can just run away from the locust wave and then re-engage after the locust wave runs out. Most of the time you can clear a base. You can start taking your own fort base. Perhaps you can even attack into carriers. All of that stuff is possible. So you see, I just cleared a Nidus after it popped, and I'm like, you know what? I can move across the map. I have 170 supply. His army consists of mainly swarm hosts. So if he uses a wave right now to kill my third base, he would get my third base, but I would get his fourth base and his third base, and maybe even his natural. I'd be straight up there because I just move straight across the map after I kill that Nidus. And I see it almost no units. I see it with my observer. I see it on the swarm host count, because don't forget, swarm hosts are extremely supply intensive. Even though he has 170 supply right now, he only has 9 roaches, 34 links, 15 swarm hosts. And in a defensive measure, swarm hosts actually aren't that great. They're mainly good at attacking. Once you force a swarm host player to become defensive, usually they've lost. So I scout that he's getting banelings, and I'm kind of afraid to engage on creep. I also, with my observer, spot a swarm host flank coming in. So you don't want to go too deep. Like I said, you don't want to attack an opponent without storm, but you can defend perfectly fine without storm. But you never want to fight locust without storm. So in this case, I'm like, okay, you know what? I kill the fourth base. I'll start my storm because I feel confident on the map now. I'm confident in my army, and I'll just retreat back home. Ideally, I would even have an observer with this army as well. So one observer to spot for stuff, one observer with this army, so you can clear the creep while you're retreating, or you clear the creep as you're attacking. If there's not a lot of creep, swarm host play becomes very difficult to do defensively. So you see, he's just looking for an opportunity to surround me, but I'm like, you know what? I'll send 3 zealots here. Either force a locust wave, or I'll force your swarm host to go back. Got a big tag on the swarm host as well. Get my own fort base. My storm and +2 are on the way. I'm like, you know what? Once I get storm out, I can just go again. And I also have an eye on the swarm host now. So the moment I see them go back into the Nidus, I can just go back up here. I can go back up here and clear that fort base. So basically, I'm forcing him to never move out with the swarm host ever again. Which is why it's very important to keep these oracles alive as well. If you can ever be aggressive on the map and get a tag on the swarm host, you have basically won the game. Because he won't be able to ever truly put them back. Because the moment you see that, you should just move out. Clear another base. Or attack and force another defensive warp in. Now, in this case, I'm just waiting for my storm and my +2. Another thing that's important is once you are maxed, and you start floating some money, just add a fleet beacon and a second stargate. Start your +1 upgrade on the cybernetics core in case he will get brute or something. A lot of the time, if people play infestation pit, so swarm host Nidus, they'll get a very fast hive because the requirement for hive is an infestation pit, of course. So it's important to note that. So here I go. I see him go back into the Nidus. I'm like, you know what? I can clear some more creep. I can threaten a little bit. I have storm at this point, so in theory I can fight. And perhaps here I actually should have fought. But I didn't really like the angle I was going for, so I decided to move around and go to the fort base. I'm like, I don't want to engage straight into that. I see a lot of banelings. His army does look a little scary for me, so I'm like, alright. I get a good tag off, and then we go where I see all of his army. I can retreat a little bit. See, I'm kind of afraid to go. And most of the time that's not a good thing. So in this case, I should have actually gone for the throat a little bit quicker. Because now he can set up run-bys and he's getting closer to Brute Lords, which is a bad situation for me. And obviously I will win this fight very easily if I actually have. I mean, I have +2, I have storms. Whenever you play against someone that has swarmos, you always want to storm the locust as much as possible. So even in the air, the flyer helper can really help with that one where to storm. So baneling and locust basically have the main priority to storm, and then it should be smooth sailing from there on out. Now, I clear the fort base, I just walk up and I see a couple of brute lords, but it's no real issue. If you're afraid brute lords might kill you in a counterattack, you just start some tempest, or you can start carriers. If you're very, very afraid, you can just clear the fort base and go back, set up run-bys, or for example, move back over here. Imagine there's 8 brute lords here right now. Just move back like this, load up 4 zealots, drop into the main, another run-by into the third, and then just get your own air units. if he ever attacks across the map with Brute Lords, you just base trade with your complete army, and then your air unit should be able to clean up the Brute Lords. Because he won't be able to reinforce with Corruptor if he's on a three base economy and you're in all three of his bases. One with a Prism, one with a Zealot run by, and one with your main army going into the natural. So this is kind of how the game should go. Now, this was a pretty perfect game and I don't expect it to go this easily. But the main things that I want you to take away from this are to cover the important areas close to your main base with a Void Ray or with Oracles. Try to make sure that as little Nidus's go up as possible. You don't need Storm unless you're moving out, going for a kill. And get a bunch of batteries at your third base. I think these are the main advices. And then perhaps one day you'll win games against Ramos Nidus. Alright, I hope this was useful for you. I hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to subscribe somewhere down there. And I'll see you boys next time.